Hello and welcome to our webinar, CanIdGate, Stance and Gait Analysis for Dogs, Basics in Theory and Practice. Nice to have you with us. My name is Mareike and I'm a member of the Zebras team in sales and support. At the beginning, I'd like to tell you something about the organizational points. If you have any questions or comments, please use the function questions and answers. The speakers will answer all your questions at the end of the presentation. We organized a little survey after the webinar, so it would be very great, and we would appreciate if you could take some minutes after the webinar to answer these few questions. Now I have the honor to hand over the floor to Dr. Alexandra Keller and Dr. Kirsten Häusler. Dr. Kirsten Häusler runs an animal rehabilitation facility in Stuttgart and helps sick dogs to get back on their feet without medication, but with a lot of exercise, expertise, human attention, and patience. Dr. Alexandra Keller is a specialist in animal chiropractic and owner of the practice Tierärztliches Orthopädie Team. Tierärztliches Orthopädie Team in Frankfurt, which is highly specialized on animal orthopedics, sports medicine and rehabilitation. Besides her curative activity, she is engaged in various fields of research and graduate and postgraduate education. The stage is yours.
Thank you, Mareike, for the nice introduction and for the invitation to talk today about the CanIdGate. I'm really proud to be part of this webinar today.
It's our pleasure.
And I'm glad to talk about our experience and about the basics in theory and in practice. So first of all, the small animal orthopedics changed in the last years. So we have got different breeds which are used in sports. We are looking more for function, we are looking more for motion, we are looking more for the sport activity. And so the focus in our veterinary work changed a little bit in the small animals. We are not only looking for bone problems, we are looking for the function, we are looking for muscle skeleton diagnosis and treatment. For that, the modern diagnostic imaging changed. So if we had years before, we had the X-rays in an analog system, now we use the digital systems. We have got high-end ultrasound, which allows us with a linear probe up to 18 megahertz to make images of the superficial tissue also in the small animals. And we have got the newest CT and MRIs in the small animal world as well, with an MRI up to 1.5 Tesla, for example. So the possibilities are amazing in this new diagnostic imaging systems. And additional to that, we do have the smartphones of the owners. They also can give us a little introduction, sometimes in the beginning of a treatment or of a diagnosis, where are the problems? So they can show us some gait videos and some points what they see at home. If we saw some images 20 years ago, I think if you can imagine what that is, then you have good luck. So I think for me it looks more like a white, black, gray picture, spotted picture, and if we see after 20 years the same image with the new machines, we see an ultrasound of the stifle in a dog. So you can expect where the ligamentum patellae is, you can expect where the adipose fat pad is, you see where the cranial cruciate ligament is. So we have got much better possibilities to image the structures. Beside that, we have to think about the functional diagnostic imaging. If we use a mobile X-ray machine, it is possible for us to do functional X-rays in dogs. So we have got a functional joint. We see in which position one bone is to the other. We see in which position and in which formation the spine is, if we can do these functional X-rays. On the other side, with the high-end ultrasound, we are able to show the superficial and the deep digital flexor tendon in the toe in a dog. As well, we can do the dynamic movements of the tendons. So we have different possibilities to diagnose problems in the muscle skeleton system. But all these nice machines and high-end technique are not good as it is if we do not have a good gait analysis before and a good manual orthopedic examination. So this doesn't replace these treatments. So gait analysis in dogs, that could be challenging. So we have got this complete different body sizes, we have got different hair lengths, we have got different behaviors on the leash. And if we see this example, we have got a Whippet Hound, which walks really good on the leash. He has got a good shape of the body. And we see also if it walks outside in front of the practice, we can decide if it is a good gait and where some differences are in the gait. Sometimes it's different if you have got other breeds, if you have got another behavior, it makes it much more complicated. Or if you have got professional sport dogs, like this sled dog, which is running every day in training time, if he's running 50 kilometers on a sled, but if he has to walk on a leash, it's really difficult. If you want to examine a gait in these dogs, it's nearly impossible. Another possibility would be a dog on a treadmill. So on a treadmill, we have got this typical gait, we have got more steps afterwards, we can focus with our eyes one point in the body and we can decide if there are some asymmetries, if there are lameness. But all of these gait analyses, also on the treadmill, it's a subjective diagnosis, or it's a subjective analysis. So it should be necessary, or it is necessary, to find an objective part, and this is the digital stance analysis and gait analysis with the Canid gait. With this pressure-sensitive treadmill, we are able to image different parts of a stance phase and as well of the gait analysis. How does it work, or which measurements we get? We are talking about that now. So the digital stance analysis is what we are using since nearly 10 years in our practice now. And we know that the normal force ratio in a standing dog is 60% in the front leg and 40% in the hind leg. And left to right should be symmetric, so 50 to 50%. So if we have got changes in that, so if we have less weight bearing on one leg, or if we have got a shifted point of gravity to the front or to the hind end, we can think about which problems are behind. So the comparison of the stance versus the trotting in dogs was done by Daryl Millis some years ago, and he showed that we can use the stance analysis as well for diagnosing some problems in the muscle skeleton system. In the Canid gait, it looks like that. So we have to place the dog on the treadmill, on the standing treadmill, it's not running. And the screen is partitioned in four parts, and the dog should stand in all of these four quarters equally. Should be standing still, that would be great, because we measure some seconds. And after that, we got a report where we see how many percent of the body weight we have got on the front leg, on the hind leg, and left and right. In this example, we see that we have got less weight on the, or less pressure on the right hind leg with only 14% compared to the other side. And the dog shifted a little bit of the weight to the front. If we think about that, the normal pressure should be 60% together. More than that, we can see the point of gravity, we can see where the body weight is focused, And in this dog, we see that we have got a little shifting point of gravity and from the weight bearing to the left side in the hind end. This is all in the standing position, and it is also possible to run the treadmill. And then we got a measurement of all these parameters in a walking, in a trotting way. We have got additionally cameras, up to 4 cameras in different position of the dog, so we can examine in slow motion, for example, and we can stop and we can measure angles in the legs and we can see how the movement is in the back. And afterwards, we got a report of that with a lot of information. And where we can use these objective gait and lameness analyses in the veterinary practice, of course, in every gait or lameness analysis, you can bring every dog on the treadmill, and it is an objective way. You can show the owner the results. You have got the results for the next examination, so that is really, really helpful. We can do additionally some physical performance tests, especially for dogs which are not really lame, which only have some performance problems in the sport, like in agility or on the racetrack. So you can run the dog for 20 minutes and measure before and after, and you see some changes in that. We also can use it for lameness evaluation after flexion test and local anesthesia. We use these methods for the small animals as well as we do that for the horses. We can see an effect of a therapy. So if you have got a lameness examination, then the diagnosis, we treat the dogs, and afterwards we can see the effect. And we can differentiate different lameness types in a dog. So it is possible to see if it is more from the toe, if it is more from the shoulder, or if it is more from the back, for example. So we have got different fields in the veterinary practice where we can use the canid gait. And now I want to switch to my colleague, Kirsten, and she will talk absolutely detailed about the simple or the single parameters we got.
So thank you very much for handing over to me, and thank you, Zebras, for having me in for this webinar, and thank you to all of the participants today. So I will talk about the canid gait in detail, but before that, I just wanted to let you know, because we always get asked, is there a validation available for the canid gait? And so myself and Matthew Allen from the University of Cambridge did an early validation study on the early Zebras canid gait machine. So you can find this at the American Journal of Veterinary Research. This is according to the protocol which was used in the human field to validate the machine. So those are early results. In between that, we did a lot of measurements, and I sent back some of, or a lot of my data to Zebras, and we made the algorithm better. And it's a really valuable tool for follow-ups in the rehab field. And that's what I'm going to show you, what we do in the rehab field. So I took one of our cases. This is an ACL repair treated with shockwave pre and post-op. And the surgery technique was a TPLO, which was done at a clinic close to us. So we worked this case up together. So let's jump in. We had a Labrador mixed breed, or Labrador mix, a female, 8 years old. She was sent to us with a suspected ACL tear, which was then proven, and we were asked to do a gait evaluation before surgery. So she came in and had an initial shockwave therapy. After that, she went to surgery and got her TPLO, and then we followed up the case after that with our treatment techniques we use in rehab. So this was the evaluation pre-surgically. She was presented with a normal event which happened. She chased whatever, a cat or a rabbit, and yelped and came back and was limping severely. So you can see that the pressure and force distribution was pretty much changed in the hind end. So she only had 26% weight bearing on her hind right leg. She was weight bearing more on the hind left leg, so it was 52%. And she was compensating on the front end as well. So we see that she was at 76% on the front left side and 68% on the front right side. Furthermore, we can look at body load distribution, we can look at the angles, how the center of pressure moves and how much they will shift over to the other side, which is a concern and which is something we want to address pretty fast, first with the surgery and in the follow-up or in the treatment plan and rehab. We want the dogs not to put as much weight on the sound side, so they won't have the highest risk of injuring that side as well. So this is where we can look at it objectively, look at the center of pressure, front and hind, look at the density and want to get this to kind of like a lying eight shaped, where you see that orange circle on the right side, which is now not even close to an eight, I would say. So this is what we want to follow up after surgery and after our treatments. So there are more gait parameters, such as step length, the width in between the steps. And we can see there is not much change in the step length, but there's a lot of changes, obviously, in weight bearing. She's pretty much even on the step width, so she's 11 centimeters in the front and in 10 in the hind. And then you can see there are some changes in the stance phase and the swing phase. So changes occur not as we might expect them to be severely different in the step length, but we can see stance phase has changed. So we will take a lot of those parameters we see into and address them and see how they change in the follow-up. So this is what we got back from the clinic we work with. That was before the surgery, and this is after surgery. So you can see the TPLO plate, and that's what we deal with in rehab afterwards. Talking about evaluating gait, when the owners send us videos, this owner did a great job in helping us to show you this case. But as you can see, the angle where we take the videos, we mostly are behind the dog and kind of like from up or down onto the dog. So we can see the dog is lame, but how would we evaluate this kind of objectively? So she's trotting, she's walking. Yes. So this is kind of like the angle which Alexandra showed you as well. So depending on where you have your cameras standing, you can decide what you want to see. You could have one from the back. You could have one from the top, from the front, wherever you think you need it. This is another dog getting shockwave therapy. This is just an image to show you how this will be applied, but this is not the cause or not why you're watching this webinar, so I just wanted to let you know how that looks. So again, these are the paw prints, and this is what we see in the report. So we evaluated the gait before going into surgery, because the dogs do walk around still. They have to go out, they have to go pee. It only takes us about 30 seconds to get those runs. This is a dog which is used to doing things because she's a rescue dog. So she was pretty much or very okay with walking on the treadmill. After 2 minutes, we had her where we needed her and took the evaluation gait, and this is what it looked like before. And what does it, or how does it look like post-surgery? So she came back in 2 days later, so we could look at the scar and the seroma, which was building up. We are in close contact with those clinics or with the veterinarians, so we did look at the knee and had a talk back to the clinic. The scar looked clean and smooth, and the seroma was due to high temperatures in July in Stuttgart. We did a follow-up. She was okay. We did the follow-up 10 days, not 2 days post-op, but we saw her. This is the scar and the swelling, and this owner is very engaged into rehab and following up. So you can see she took pictures. Those are her pictures. 1 day post-op, 3 days post-op, 5 days post-op. So this is what it looks like. And those are the shockwave treatments we had. We did six shockwave treatments, and in between we had the follow-up at the clinic. And after there was a follow-up with the clinic. And there is a dog which is joining us for telling how, what we're doing. So we had the follow-up at the clinic, and the surgeon was very okay with what we were doing in rehab and how the healing went. And so this is what we saw. This was 6 weeks post-op. So there is good fracture healing. Some changes in that knee, but she had that before, and she was doing pretty good. So this is a combination. You can look at or comparison of the pre-surgical gait analysis and the post-surgical gait analysis 2 months. 2 months after surgery. So as you can see, I told you about those changes. So we had 26%, which was followed up at the in September, and we went up to 43%, which was a good increase, and we could lower the pressure rate on the front left, and also could lower the force distribution or the pressure and weight distribution on the hind left. So what else can we see? There is a lot of change in the center of pressure. So the angle is not as steep anymore. We compare the body load distribution from pre-surgical to post-surgical, and we went from minus 13.7 degrees to only minus 3 degrees, which is a pretty good result. And we increased the area of the paw print, which is on the hind right side of the left picture, 44 square meters to 64.4 square meters. We can also look at force curves and step patterns, and those are shown. All of those gait parameters and images and pictures are shown in the report, which we have immediately after we run the dog on the treadmill, and this is how those changes or what those changes look like. I particularly like the average step patterns because it helps you understand how they get more symmetrical. Basically, is that what you see on the treadmill while it runs, just pushed together and averaged. So this is her 11 weeks post-op and 4 weeks post the last treatment. So there are still some changes, but we have a T below, so we have angle changes in the dog, in the biomechanics, but we were pretty happy with those results. Here is another angle for you to look at the dog walking on the treadmill. So we have a camera seated on the ceiling, so we can look at the spine and how the spine moves. And we try not to drag the dog or keep it or force it, so we want them to run, to walk or trot on the treadmill without us taking pressure off by pulling or putting pressure on by dragging them, so they have to walk freely so we get objective results. So here are some gait pattern and changes over time. So on the far left side, you can see again the pre-surgical image, which we have seen before. In the middle part of the screen, you will see the rerun in the or the follow-up in September. And on the right side, that is 11 weeks post-op and post our shockwave and the underwater treadmill, balance treatments, balance exercises, and the rehabilitation program we run at our clinics. So you can see the center of pressure of the whole body, which is the in the beginning, the kind of steep line and got more horizontal throughout the treatment plan, has changed from minus 13.7 degrees to minus 1.9, almost not noticeable. And you can see that the paw, the shape of the paw, of the hind right paw, has changed a lot. This dog, I don't know if you've seen it before, but this dog has severe hip dysplasia as well, but she's pretty good with her muscle mass, and the surgeon said that they will not interfere right now because she's using her hip and her legs quite properly. And as you can see, she is not weight shifting a lot anymore, so we have 65% in the front, 65 and 66, 44 and 41%, which is a pretty good result after a short time of recovery. So again, we will look at the parameters and how they changed. So this is pre-surgical record A, you can see. This is the white record, and the other one is with the light blue background. So looking at those changes in step length, you could see all of those lengths have increased. So the front and the hind step length has increased. We see a lot of changes in the hind reach, how far the back paw reaches into the front paw print on the treadmill or on the plate. And we can see that the stride length has increased, which means that she pulls forward and has a more steady gait while she's walking. The cadence has decreased more than 23 steps per minute, so she is walking much more smoothly now. So this is to be followed up. We do follow-ups every 3 to 6 months post-op, depending, or post-treatment, depending on how frequently the owners come in. This one is a very good owner. She comes in very frequently due to the injuries in this dog. So I will hand over again to Alexandra to show you some cases from her practice.
Yeah, so cases. Every time it's interesting to see really practical cases, and after this nice presentation after pre and after TPLO and the changes in the gait, I thought about what can I bring up for a basic case. So I thought about, at this time we have a lot of them, I thought about a little puppy. So we have got this little Carlo. He was 5 months old when he was presented in a practice with an acute lameness. I will tell you in which leg, because maybe you can see it. And as I said before, sometimes it's challenging to do a lameness or a gait analysis, and to do that in young dogs, in really young dogs, that could be maybe one part. So you can see that this dog is not really handled with a leash, so he walks left, right, and he's not really well behaved in walking next to the owner. But in this case, I'm sure you can see it. I hope you can see the transfer with the zoom. Sometimes I know that their movies are stop in between. So in this dog, we saw also outside a lameness in the right hind end. And after this gait, we also run the dog, or run Carlo on the treadmill, and only to have an objective gait analysis. And what you see, this is on the left side. What we can see is that in the right hind leg, we do have a less pressure load on the leg. So we have got only 47% if we compare that to the left side with 63. And after a detailed examination, orthopedic examination, we can diagnose a distortion of the stifle affected a little bit the adductor muscles in the hip. And so we got a therapy for this little Carlo, that he has to slow down a little bit to get controlled exercise. And 40 days later, the owner came back. And for the owner, the dog was absolutely fine again. So he couldn't, or she couldn't, recognize any lameness. She couldn't recognize any pain in the dog. And walking outside in the gait analysis with the dog, which runs left and right and fore and back, it was a gait analysis without any lameness for my subjective analysis, for my subjective eyes. But if we bring, well, if you let the dog run again on the canid gait, we saw that Carlo still have less weight bearing on the, or less weight on the right hind end. So also in the orthopedic examination, he was still a little bit painful, but for the owner, it is much more helpful if the owner can see changes like that. So it was really easy to tell the owner, please, another 14 days, do less, do controlled exercise with your little puppy. And after the time, she came back, and then Carlo was quite equal. This was one case, only a step, that you can see also in little puppies. You can use the treadmill. It is possible to run the little puppies on a treadmill. They run outside, they jump, they do everything. It's not a pain for them. They do it with fun. They do it sometimes with some treats in front. But all of them, most of the times, do it really, really easy. So then I thought about another case. And I know that we normally talk today about dogs, but I want to mention that we also can use cats with a canid gait. So this is a little cat, Bossy. She jumped or fall out of the third floor because I think she wants to go out, because she loves birds and she wants to climb on trees and everything, when she was really young. So the owner didn't came to a veterinarian, because after one day she runs nearly normal, but after a time the owner recognized some swelling and that she still is a little bit painful in the front leg. And during the examination there were diagnosed that she broke her metacarpals in the left front leg. And for us, as we are looking all the time for gait and as we are looking for good function, we are really interested if this little cat is able to have a good function in the foot and have a good function in the toes, which is really important for cats, especially if they want to go out and climb on trees. And we tried to run her on the treadmill, and it was really possible. So it only takes a short time, and after that she runs on it like a dog. She did a really, really good job. And the interesting thing also, if she has got this broken metacarpals, she didn't shift so many weight. She has a little bit less weight on the left front. And the only thing what we see is that the pressure point on the left toe in front is a little bit different to the right side. So that's a little bit of changes, but it is not affecting so much. And if we recheck the function of the toe, it works perfect. And at this time, I can say this little cat is now in our family, so she's running out in the garden, she's climbing on trees. Sometimes she catches some mice, and sometimes she catches some birds. And so she's a really happy cat. But it is also possible sometimes to use the treadmill for cats as well. Together, I can say that it is an important tool for diagnosis and therapy in the veterinary practice. If we can, if we have the chance to have this objective analysis of the gait, we can use it for multiple different applications, and we can use it, of course, for stance and for gait. It depends where we need maybe the one part more. And another really interesting thing is that we have got a much better customer satisfaction if we can give out a printed report, if we have got the data they can take home as a take-home message, and if they come back, they got a comparison of that. So all over, I really can recommend it to add it in your daily practice. And now I want to give again to my colleague, because she wants to present some interesting things.
So as we both are engaged in research and are really interested in what we do and how we can use those tools not only in a clinical setup but also for research, we know that looking at dogs outside, even though they're limping, is very interesting, and to spot a severe limping dog is not too bad for anybody else. You can see the dog is limping, but what is normal gait and how does gait develop? So we are quite interested in what is actually normal gait. And if we think about different dog breeds, looking at a Chihuahua and looking at a Great Dane, for example, we do have some research being done by Professor Martin Fischer from the University of Jena. So there we know a lot of things, but we don't know enough. And so we got in touch with the whole team. And this is a new study. Next to what we've done before, we did some evaluation of the canid gait in comparison with force plates and with mats, pressure mats. So those are to be published, or those are in works. So you can look at those publications pretty soon, I hope. But there is another study we wanted to let you know about. So now we're looking at fundamentals of gait development. What do we know about the puppies and their gait, and how does it develop during them aging? So this is our team. So we have Professor Martin Fischer. Martin, there's a a typo. And we have Dr. Katja Zönel. They are both from the University of Jena. We have Julia Schibilla as a veterinarian in the north of Germany. We have Alexandra Keller and myself in the south and in Frankfurt. So, and what do we do? So these are things that interest us. So we have a puppy. This is Al Capone, an old German Shepherd breed. So the first video is him walking on the canid gait as young as 9 weeks. So you can see he is not forced or dragged or whatever. He walks pretty freely on the treadmill. And then we have him at 14 and a half weeks walking on the treadmill. He kind of looks like more like a bear than a dog still. So that changed a lot. He just turned a year now. So those were some preliminary studies or evaluations we did. So now we have a study out there. And we want to know what happens not only in 2 weeks between those runs. So these are the measurements we took. You can see those images and the report we saw before. So this is using the tool for normal gait or for evaluating how they age and what happens while they age, not for injuries. So it's also useful for this. And it's nice for the owner to look at those images and get a report. And if you want to know more about our work and what we do, our website will be online pretty soon. Maybe even today, I don't know. So it's all very fresh. But yeah, that's all I wanted to say. And thank you, Alexandra, for joining me. And thank you to the team. It was a great pleasure for us to be here and let you know about what we do for, yeah, in our free time and in our clinical work. Okay.
Yeah.
Are there any questions? If you feel free to reach out to us. Let us know if there's anything we can answer now. If we don't see any questions coming up, you can also ask us questions after the webinar. Just contact the team or us.
Yeah, there's a question.
There's a question. I might answer that question and then you can jump in. So as me being a physiotherapist, I'm a certified canine rehabilitation practitioner, but I'm not a vet. So this opportunity of the question is, if the dog is afraid of the treadmill, do you think that light sedation can be used for gait analysis? I would not recommend that. And I have never needed it. So sometimes I decide I will not do the gait analysis at the first time or the first visit because sometimes they are a bit insecure. But there are very, very, very few dogs that will not walk on the treadmill. Yes, so what is your experience?
So I absolutely agree with you. And we never need a sedation for the running on the treadmill. Maybe one point is with the sedation, that is what is discussing in lameness diagnostic, that lameness is a little bit better for evaluation if the dog is a little bit sedated because you copy that from the horses. But to be honest, that is never... we never use that in the dogs. So we more use the local anesthesia for find an improvement of the gait. And if the dog is not, or if he's afraid from the treadmill in the beginning, we take a little bit more time. And most of the times, I would say more than 90% are walking on the treadmill. At least in a walk, sometimes not in the trot, but in a walk, at least you got most of the dogs walking. I think we do not have more questions. So I can say thank you to all of the team, to the nice organization here, and I hope we can come back. More questions.
There's another one.
So the question is, how many time do you spend to take a report? So I can say the report is really easy because you have to do the measurement and then it's only one click on the system and you got the complete report. The only thing you have to do before is if you have got as many cycles of the duty cycles, sometimes you have got times in between where the dog is not walking really equal, so you have got a little, if you make the cycles a little bit closer, that you have got at least 10 or maybe 20 cycles, and then you click and you have got a report where you got all the data we saw before.
And I think there's another thing which you have to keep in mind is if you just want to evaluate the walk, it will not take you as long, but the treadmill is able to do an incline, do a decline, it goes up to 20 kilometers. So what we most of the times do is that we have them walk and trot, if possible, and might even look at an incline and a decline. So depending on what you want to do, or it does take a little bit more time, but I would say one report, a normal one, would maybe possible in 5 to 7 minutes.
So the next question is, can the treadmill walk and analyze during walking or running? Yes, so we have got the possibility up to 20 kilometers per hour. So in the most of the dogs, it should be running. Yes, most of the times it's a little bit dangerous if they're really going for galloping, but walking and trotting every time is possible.
And maybe if you would do a performance evaluation, you can have them run for a quite long time and then do both. So, yeah. Yes. So, do we have some more questions? I cannot see any.
So. No, I don't think so.
Yeah, we cannot see. So.
Good. So, thank you.
So, we'll hand over.
And many thanks for our speakers for presenting the informative and interesting points and presentations. So many thanks to Dr. Keller and Dr. Häusler. Many thanks for you, and also many thanks for our team behind the scenes for making this to a great webinar. And thanks for you for joining, for participating. Many thanks. And as we already told you, if you have questions, please ask them after the webinar by email or just call the sales team. So now I'd like to ask you for joining the survey. We make a little few questions for you, so it would be very great if you could take some few minutes and answer these questions so that we are improving our webinars for the further times. So yeah, many thanks. Thank you and goodbye.